The answer is we wanted to put in all the things which mattered. What is it? Where is it? So in terms of what is it, it's basically financial reserve, financial assets, cash, shares, bonds, maybe private equity, some other financial instruments, you may own companies. Or if it's not financial assets, it's land areas, meaning fixed assets, buildings. Those are the big things which you could touch and convert and spend. And in Chinese, there's a phrase, 变卖典当. If you are desperate, what do? What you have, you convert it, you sell it, you pledge it, you pawn it. Whatever it is, you convert it, take cash and spend the cash. And what we wanted to do was to catch all the things which could be converted, which could be sold, which could be pledged, which could be pawned. And it's basically financial assets, companies, and land. Then, where are these things which can be pledged and sold? So, financial items, MAS, of course, has money. Temasek, of course, has got companies, and that readily can be converted to money. GIC manages money. And then you have the CPF money, which is Singaporeans' savings. It's not really the government's money, but if the government is not completely straight with you, they could do something there and that money can be at risk. So those things have to be covered. Then you have the land. Who has the land? JTC has the land because you have big pieces of Singapore which are industrial estates, land, land to be developed, land which has been reclaimed. And then you have HDB, because HDB has also got factory land. HDB has got land which is people's houses. And that also is a valuable financial asset. So therefore, we ended up with six so-called Schedule 5 entities, where there's the second key applies. The president has oversight and veto on the key names on the board and the CEO. And we want to make sure that that money doesn't get spent lightly. It doesn't quite cover 100% of what the government has. There are other stat boards, there are other assets, other parts of the other things. There's a national collection in the National Museum. I mean, the Farquhar collection of paintings of flora and fauna, for example. These are all valuable things, but in the scheme of things, the big pieces, we have identified them and we've covered them under the second key. I think the key pivot was when we decided to recognize the reserves as being a lot of money and needing to have a second key. The idea was first floated by Mr. Lee Kuan Yew in 1984 in his National Day rally. I remember it because that was the year I came into politics and I attended the rally, and he talked about this. And then over the next few years, we worked out the scheme and we implemented the scheme. And I was intimately involved in that with Professor Jayakumar, particularly also with Mr. Goh Chok Tong, who was then Deputy Prime Minister. We worked on the white paper, which we put out in 1988. It was a big issue in the election, general election in 1988. We worked on the legislation to amend the constitution to provide for the elected president. I was particularly deeply involved in all the ins and outs of that with Prof. Jaya. He made the drafts. I gave him inputs. I helped redraft, clarify, present differently, come up with ideas, try to understand what the problem was and how to pin down so that you protect the reserves, but you don't paralyze the government of the day. Because it's very easy to lock it all up, then you're not allowed to do anything with it. Well, you can do that, but then it becomes useless to you. So what is the mechanism by which you can protect it, lock it, and yet when you need to, unlock it, and without the risk that all of it will disappear? I think that was the key turning point because it crystallized people's focus. They knew that there's such a thing called the reserves that is quite a lot of money and that it needs to be protected. And of course, there's the idea But when can we use it? When we need it. And that's something which we discuss every now and again. Since then, we have made many adjustments, refinements, modifications to the arrangements for the elected president, for the second key. But that fundamental turning point was the decision to crystallize the idea and to implement such a system. One day, if you have a rogue government, everything is finished. And that was the way we explained it, we marketed it, that one day, if you have a freak election, you have the wrong team in charge, you have a rogue government who wants to raid the reserves, in one term, all your life savings of generations of Singaporeans will be gone. And therefore, we must prevent that. Not just if you have a rogue government, but even for the proper operation of a good government, you want to have guide rails, limits, this a realization that, yes, these are all resources available to the government, but some of it is daily spending money, some of it is budgeted for your short, medium-term, annual needs, but some of it really, even as a working government, you should not think of as just part of the same pot of money. You should put it as a separate pot, and this is something which you will only think of touching if you really, really need to touch it, which is only once in a while. It was a pivotal moment, but there was a build-up to it. Bear Stearns had happened in March 2008. Lehman Brothers had collapsed in September 2008. And after Lehman Brothers, the other banks started to run into trouble and confidence started to be shaken. And then in October, with confidence being shaken not just in America, but even in Europe and elsewhere in the world, governments in Europe, starting I think in Ireland and then on the continent, started to worry that their banking systems may collapse and began to give government guarantees on the deposits in those banking systems. So when one country does that, the country who hasn't done that, his banks may be fine, but anybody who has money in that bank says, why should I take the risk? I will go over and take that government guarantee. I assume the government won't go bust. And then that may cause you to run into trouble. So as a result, when Ireland did it, other European governments started to do it. And within days, it spread to our part of the world, to Australia, to Hong Kong. This was October 2008. So I rang up Mr. Goh Chok Tong, who was then chairman MAS. I said, well, we better react. You can't just stand around, because otherwise, if Hong Kong has a guarantee and we don't have a guarantee, well, what will happen? That people, deposits will move, even if there's nothing wrong with our banking system. So we decided we needed to guarantee our deposits. And to guarantee our deposits meant that there would be a contingent liability on the reserves. Because how can you pay for the guarantee? How can you back the guarantee? $150 billion is more than double your annual government budget. Money has to come from somewhere. So we said we'll back it with $150 billion from the reserves. So we went to the president in October. We briefed the CPA. They asked a lot of questions. The president approved this contingent draw on the reserves. As it turned out, we were lucky. The Singapore banks and the foreign banks in Singapore were all okay, and we didn't actually have to touch any of the $150 billion. But it was a real contingent liability. It could have been needed. So that was October. Then as we watched the situation unfold, we got more and more worried. So by November, we knew that we were heading into a very serious storm. So the next year in 2009, instead of being in February as usual, the budget was in January. We decided on two big measures. One, the jobs credit scheme, $4 point something billion to keep people at work, and the government would help to pay a significant part of their wages, effectively their CPF. And then secondly, the special risk sharing initiative to make sure that companies who needed credit could continue to get credit, and good companies wouldn't just die because the credit lines dried up and the banks didn't lend to them. We wanted to make sure that the economy kept going. So it all added up to a package of about $5 billion. I went to see the president. President had been following this closely. He said to me, the moment has come. He took my proposal. The CPA studied the proposal. They worked through it. They approved it. We implemented the scheme. We sailed through the crisis. As it turned out, the crisis passed faster than we expected. And then the economy really took off vigorously. And we had the growth went up. So that was the first time we went in and we spent the reserves. Because the economy turned so quickly, we were able to make good the amount. And before the end of that term of government, we were able to pay back what we drew from the past reserves and put back into the past reserves and make good. First of all, the scale was so enormous. And it came very much more suddenly upon us. Because with the global financial crisis, you could see bear stearns was in March. Then gradually problems built up. Slowly the awareness came. Then Lehman Brothers. Then gradually the impact on the economy and so on. But with COVID from December 2019 to February 2020, it from a strange bug somewhere in one city in Wuhan, it became a global problem and we had to react. When we prepared the budget, we were in 2020, Heng Swee Keat was the finance minister, we were expecting rough weather. DPM Heng discussed with me and we made what we thought was a quite generous package to see Singaporeans through the rough weather. We thought we did not need to use reserves at that point. Went to see the president, briefed the president. President said, would you like to use reserves if you would need to? Seeing the situation, she would be prepared to consider it. But at that point, we felt okay. We said, no, we don't need to do that. After we delivered the budget, within days and weeks, the situation changed. We had to have supplementary budgets within less than a month. And by the time we went into the supplementary budget, we knew that this was the storm of the century and we had no choice. We had to use the reserves. So we went to the president, we made the case, and we did what we needed to do. And fortunately, we had the resources and we could do it. And we came out of this. We preserved Singaporeans' jobs, we looked after livelihoods, and we didn't have to go into debt. It's a great blessing. I had no doubt we were doing the right thing. What we needed to do, we were doing. I was relieved that we were not held back because of lack of resources to do, at least not lack of dollars to do what we needed to do. It could have been overdone, but in such situations, it is not worth trying to fine-tune. You make the major decision, make the big move. If you've overdone it, well, I bought more insurance than I needed, but no great harm done. If it's not enough, better make another decisive move, which is what happened. The first budget turned out not enough. We had to make further decisive moves. But overall, in the end, we did not spend all of the money we expected. I think finance tells us we overall spent about 30 plus billion in 2020, and over the next 2 years, 2021, 2022, added up, we spent about $40 billion, somewhat less than we had expected, but still a very, very substantial sum. The vaccine cost us, I think, $1 or $2 billion, something like that. So compared to the 40B spending, it was not a big part. But certainly, just to be able to say, I want it, I want to order it, I'm going early, and if I have to order three times over, I will do that. I think if we didn't have the reserves, we would not have that mindset to take such a robust approach. Then you will be like some other countries were doing. You'll be bargaining, you'll be trying to argy-bargy, can I have it slightly cheaper, can I have it, can I trade off earlier, later? And by then, somebody else will have gone in and it will be left in the dust, which is what happened to the countries which went for this haggling, bargaining approach. We went in, we knew we wanted to buy insurance, we knew it would help to get the economy open faster, we knew it would save lives, and we were able to do that.
This vault belongs to the Singapore government, and no media outlet has ever been granted access before. That's because it contains part of Singapore's reserves, and the authorities wanted the location kept secret.